Thank you. So, in this last lecture, my plan is to give just a couple of applications of Fekete points. And the first one is they are not very deep things. They are just some elementary corollaries of what we had, but it's just to illustrate why some of the study of these extremal points can be used. And the first one is about this problem on random matrix theory. This is what's called an spherical ensemble. What's an spherical ensemble? This was some object introduced from mathematically by Krishnapur. It was studied by physicists before, and it's the following point process. You take two matrices, A and B, random matrices, n by n, with identically distributed independent entries, and we look at the eigenvalues associated to the pair, the generalized eigenvalues. That means the eigenvalues of, these are just so these are eigenvalues of this type of problem. No? So these are so you have your matrices, which is n by n, n by n, all the entries independent of A and of B, and all of them normal 0, 1, and then one is interested in the study of how these eigenvalues are distributed. So that's called an spherical ensemble, and the reason is the following. Krishnapur, he computed the joint density of the eigenvalues. So zeta I, zeta j denote the eigenvalues of this matrix, and it has this density in the plane, considered as points in the plane, with respect to the Lebesgue measure. So this is the density. And if I took the effort to make a computation, just take these two matrices, make a numerical experiment. How do they look like? So you take these two matrices, and then I made this, and I instead of drawing the how do you call this, the eigenvalues in the plane, I will just make it and put them on the sphere by this spherical projection. And in the next, this is how they look. This was a 2000 by 2000 matrix. Well, two of these matrices, you take them and you put them in the spherical projection, and you see, this is about the biggest you could do with my computer, but they look pretty uniform. I mean, it's not that in this region or this region there are more, they look pretty uniform. And if you believe that these are uniform, then we don't have to do anything else, because that's what I wanted to check, that with the Fekete points you can prove that the distribution is going to be uniform of these random eigenvalues. And if you take this, you take the density and you pull it back to the sphere by the stereographic projection, then actually this quantity is just the product of the distances square in this. So obviously here the density is invariant under rotations. You can see it here. This is but the point is that we want to see how a typical eigenvalue looks like. And now you give a realization of the random point process. So you take two matrices, you throw them, and you look at the spectral measure. So this is the direct deltas on the spectra of this generalized eigenvalue problem. And now we take a sequence mu n of independent processes of the spherical sum. So we take a matrices of size 2, of size 3, of size 4, and so on, and I construct the random spectra in this way. And and I denote this by mu n. And the normalized measure on the sphere is denoted by mu. So mu is just the surface measure on the sphere. And then the theorem that we will prove is that with probability 1, this is not was just by luck that they were uniformly distributed, but rather mu n converges weakly to this here. And moreover, we can even compute, well, have at least one upper bound for the Kantorovich-Wasserstein distance in between mu n and mu with probability 1. Okay, so this is an application. Remember that what we had before, we proved in the last lecture, was that the Fekete points had the property that this distance was bounded by 1 over the square root of n. Yeah? So the Fekete points were, if we go back here, the Fekete points are the points where this density is maximal. Okay, so for the mode, this thing is going okay. But now I want to prove that this is happening almost surely with probability 1. Okay? Go ahead.
So is this log n factor optimal?
we'll come to that. Okay. No, I'm not sure. I'm not sure. I will. No, just come on. Wait, and you will see where it comes from. Okay. So, well. Okay. So, what do we do? First, we consider the space of functions, which is of this type, where p is a polynomial of degree smaller than n, and I just divide by this fixed constant, which makes it is just so that it's bounded in infinity, right? So this thing, I just take the space pn is the polynomials, but normalized in this way. I divide by this growth factor. Well, clearly pn is in L2 of mu. Mu, I said it was the Riemann surface, the surface on the sphere, but by some abuse of notation, I will also consider it, when I put it back in the plane, the measure on the sphere by the stereographic projection, I still call it mu. Okay, so it's this measure mu. So this is, of course, a reproducing kernel Hilbert space, and it's very easy to compute the reproducing kernel because, well, since this is radial, you just have that zeta to the n are orthogonal, and you normalize and compute the reproducing kernel here, and the reproducing kernel of Pn is exactly this quantity. So it's perfectly explicit. I have the reproducing kernel computed here. Now, we try to do, if not use the Fekete points, at least to use the same ideas that we were using before, and we observe the following. If Qn, well, okay, let's take Qn is an orthonormal. I take an orthonormal basis for the space of polynomial. Well, this space of polynomials, and we have, of course, that the product of these two matrices is just the matrix of reproducing kernels. And therefore, if I take the determinant here, this is the determinant square of the basis of the reproducing kernels at any given point. Okay, so far, so good. No? Now, observe. Okay. Well, this is again this is the Lagrange. This is given any points, not necessarily the Fekete points. Any set of points, and we define the Lagrange functions. So this is just the Lagrange polynomials, well, pseudo polynomials, because we were dividing by these normalizing factors. So this is a set of polynomials which have a value 0 at all points except at the point zeta jota, which is equal to 1, and observe the following: the density of the spherical ensemble is this determinant. Why is this so? Okay, let's go back. Observe this expression. The determinant here was the square of this other determinant, right? But the square of this determinant, this was an orthonormal basis, right? It was an orthonormal basis. Therefore, this one is just like a multiple of zeta 1. This was a multiple of zeta square. This was a multiple of zeta cube, etc. So this one is the van der Mond. The thing that's introduced in the van der Mond, this is a van der Mond square. Right? So if this was a van der Mond square, and we go back to the computation that Krishnapur was doing, this is the van der Mond square, and these are the normalizing factors that I have introduced. Right? So exactly this density, which was computed by Krishnapur, one can see that coincides the density is this thing here, which is in itself is the density of this determinant of reproducing kernels, right? So finally, we found out that the density of these generalized eigenvalues is the determinant of these reproducing kernels. And moreover, the Lagrange square, the Lagrange was the quotient of these two things. So the Lagrange square is the density at this point zeta divided by the density the Lagrange to the power square, because the Lagrange function was just the quotient of those two of these determinants. Very good. So, but now this is very nice. This is very nice because this object, whenever we have a point process zeta one zeta n that's given by the determinant of a of some reproducing kernel here, this is a very well known object. This is called a determinantal point process. This has some special. This has been very much studied, especially in the physics literature, because these somehow these models, the determinantal point processes in general, model what they call the fermion particles. No, whenever we have something that repel each other, this is the modeled by a determinantal point process, and this is one of these cases. So these eigenvalues of this spherical ensemble is a determinantal point process. Well, this is just something that we keep in mind. Now, we are going to try to do the same trick that we did with the Fekete points. We are going to try to compute the distance of the empirical measure, the Dirac deltas, to the uniform measure on the sphere by way of this Kantorovich-Wasserstein distance. The point here is that we don't have anymore. We don't have control on the size of the Lagrange function, because we are not in the Fekete points. In the case of the Lagrange function, in the Fekete points, this was bounded by one. This is no longer the case. Okay, so what we do? Well, nevertheless, we try to construct a transport plan. We construct a transport plan which is just similar to the one that we had before. This is some Dirac deltas, the reproducing kernels, the Lagrange, and now we introduce this measure here, because this is the measure that we are dealing with. Well, we compute the marginals. Let's compute the marginals of this object. If I integrate in the first variable, integrate in the zeta variable, this is the reproducing kernel, so this was one, so we get this marginal. And if I sum up if I integrate in the variable w, well, then I just get one, and I get this sum, oops, I get the sum here from j, this sum here, which is the reproducing kernel. But the reproducing kernel in the diagonal, now it's exactly, if you take a look at the reproducing kernel on the diagonal, this is just one. So we've got the only thing that's left, it's here, it's a uniform measure, right? So the marginals of this admissible transport plan are exactly this measure and this measure. And therefore, if I want to compute, this is not Bn, eh? This is this mu n. Now I want to compute the Kantorovich distance in between the mu n and the uniform measure. This is, I just have to integrate this thing here, and I've got this estimate. Okay. And now I don't have estimates for Lj, so I cannot put this smaller than one. But what can we do? Well, actually, what we are going to compute is the expected. The expectation, no? of the expectation of the Kantorovich distance. So I just take the quantity that we had and I integrate against the density, and I do just brutal Cauchy's bars here to estimate these things. And now we use the explicit expression that we have for the reproducing kernel. And in the explicit expression for the reproducing kernel, we have some off-diagonal decay, which is this thing, this integral here. When I integrate with respect to this distance, I win something, and this is uniform integrable. But this is completely trivial, eh? In this setting. We don't have to appeal to some fancy theorems of off-diagonal decay of the reproducing kernel, because the kernel is It's explicit. I had it before. This is just an integral of some polynomials. You can estimate this quickly. And this is completely trivial in this setting. These two estimates, and if you plug this one, we get that we've got this expression. So now that we have this estimate for the expectation, and now remember that the relationship that we had. This is where we win, is in between this is the reason we did some Cauchy Schwarz, because the Lagrange to the square was related to the density of this point process, and I can swap, I can change these two pieces by the density replacing zeta j by zeta. So here we are using the relation that there is in between the Lagrange function and the density of the process by this. And now, once we are here, once we have replaced this by this, then we are done, because this integral here, when we integrate in the variable zeta, this is uniformly bounded, so I can throw this integral away, and essentially what's left is the integral of rho n with respect to all the other variables, and this was a density measure, and we managed to get this constant here. Good. So we win. So, well, that's what I was doing here. And at the end, what we have here, what we can do is that what happens is that we can compute the expectation in terms, it's 1 over n. So we have that the expectation of the distance is like 1 over n. But so we have not lost anything. I mean, the Fekete points had the distance was at distance. There's something fishy here. Ay, ay, ay. Nah. Yeah. What? Yeah, this is wrong. This is n. It should be square root of n. I was thinking how it can be. This n here that I. Sorry about it. There's a typo here. Yeah. So here there is an n, and here you get a square root of n, which is what it should be, because this is what the Fekete points were. Sorry. I mean, now I was here. I missed it up. Thank you. So we have we are at distance a square root of n, typically. I mean, just like in the Fekete points, we computed the expected values, and it's a square root of n. But now we need. So we have not lost anything. That's what I mean. I mean, in the expectation, we have not lost anything. We are just getting the best possible. And then we use something which is special of the terminantal point process. In the terminantal point processes, there is this phenomenon of concentration of the measure. This is just like it's a Talagrand type theorem, where everything is very close to the expectation, right? So this is a sort of this is some result of Pimental and Perez, that whenever we have a determinantal point process and we have a Lipschitz one functional, this means with norm one on finite counting measure with respect to the total variation distance, right? Then we cannot deviate very much from the expectation, right? So if the difference is bigger of f from the expectation is bigger than a, we have this exponential decay. So all the probability constant, and this is general, completely general for an arbitrary determinantal point process. And here is where the log comes from. And in that, in this case, well, one can check that if we take this functional, which is n times the counting measure divided by n, this distance, this is a Lipschitz one with respect to total variation, and therefore we apply our result here to this functional, and the probability that just picking a to be square root of n log n in that previous statement, and we get that the probability that the Kantorovich distance is bigger than this thing is smaller than 1 over n square, and then just by Borel-Cantelli this thing is smaller than this with almost sure. Okay, so this thing here is something that Well, this type of argument, this finishes the proof. Yeah? But this type of argument can be done in several variables, with determinantal point processes in several variables, as we did. And in that case, you don't get the log. So this is some phenomenon of one complex variable. In higher complex variable, we get that this thing is like 1 over square root of n. Whether this is an artifact of the proof, I don't know. It's certainly one should, I mean, we cannot expect to improve our estimate on the expectation, because that's the best we can hope, but maybe this large deviation estimate maybe can be better in the case of this particular, because this is a theorem for completely general determinantal point processes, but for our particular one, I don't know whether one could.
In several variables, so this estimate is better.
No, in several variables, when you do the problem is that then the number n, the dimension does not coincide with the degree of the polynomial. And then you can pick a to be a square root of n, and then you get something which is summable already.
It's like integration 1 over x, dimension is
higher,
just you have no logarithm.
When dimension is higher, there is no logarithm. And here we don't need to take this logarithm. Here I need to take the logarithm in order to make this summable. Okay, so that was one application. The next application, and here I'm sorry for the people who attended the Marseille conference, because this will be some repetition, but not all of you were there. It's some application of Fekete points to the flat polynomials. Yeah? So now I'm going to consider the following problem. We want to construct polynomials which are flat in the sense that the L2 norm and the L infinity norm is close one to each other. So the Riluboyatovich polynomials are it's a sequence of homogeneous polynomials in n variables such that the L2 norm of the polynomials is one, and the supremum is bounded. They don't peak too much. Yeah, and this is one key ingredient on the construction, one of the constructions of inner functions in the ball. Good. And in dimension two, here we have only one polynomial for each homogeneous degree. For each degree, we can build one polynomial. But in dimension two, one can do a slightly better. Bourguin found an orthonormal basis of H2 by finding uniformly bounded orthonormal basis of each PK. PK are the homogeneous holomorphic in two variables of degree K. So when I restrict myself to polynomials of degree K, one can find an orthonormal basis here, which is uniformly bounded. From the existence of these Riluboyatovich polynomials, just knowing one, there is a trick that one can construct a basis in any dimension. In any dimension, one can construct a basis of uniformly bounded polynomials. This is possible, but by cheating a bit using these polynomials. But what's not so clear is that one can find a uniformly bounded basis of the homogeneous polynomial of each PK separately. Okay, so we have this is still an open question to know whether there is a bounded orthonormal basis of PK. When I mean bounded uniformly for all K. Okay. So that's the setting is this, no? That we have in H2, for instance, in this dimension 3. In here, which is this sum, no? Here there is a basis. But I don't know how to find the basis for each one, which in such a way that it's, they are orthonormal and they are uniformly bounded here. Okay. Well, and in this direction, trying to find these bases, Schiffman constructed a bounded orthonormal system of homogeneous polynomials of degree k in the unit ball, but the number of orthonormal polynomials is not the whole dimension. We don't reach the whole dimension. So we have nk. So in here we have that, well, we have the dimension of pk, we almost reach the dimension. Well, we almost. When beta, this beta depends on the dimension of the ball. So, for instance, in C3, in dimension 3, I think that beta is 0.99. So there's almost, we managed to get almost all of them. Yeah? But in dimension 6, I think it's already 0.14 only. So there's so as the dimension increases, we are losing in this game.
By the way, in the simplest setting of real rotation polynomials, is it possible to use the Fricker points to get good estimates of the constants? I mean, just the
well, that's what we're going to do.
Okay.
Okay. So that's you are too quick now. Well, the theorem that we have is the following: that we are going to improve this thing. But we are not going to reach a basis. But still, we are going to improve the number of polynomials that we get, and in the following sense. So, given for any dimension n, for any epsilon, there is a constant such that the collection of nk, or we can build a collection of orthonormal homogeneous polynomials of degree k, with the number of points being as close as you want to the dimension, and with the supremum. Bounded, uniformly bounded for all k. So we can get as close as we want to the to being an orthonormal basis, but not quite, because this, of course, this uniform bound explodes with epsilon. Okay, how one approaches this? Okay, sorry about this, but this. It's more convenient for me because I want to express it. Use the results on the Fekete points that we had in complex manifolds to identify the holomorphic polynomials, the homogeneous holomorphic polynomials with sections of this line bundle. Yeah? And in this case, when we make this identification, the LP norm of the section is the same as the LP norm of the associated polynomials when I restrict it to the sphere. So there is no loss in this identification. I can move to the to this line bundle. And the theorem, actually what we prove is this theorem, which implies the other one, that whenever we have an Hermitian holomorphic line bundle over a compact Kellner manifold with positive curvature, which is the case in the sphere, and now I'm rephrasing the same result, we have sections in which are orthonormal holomorphic sections in the space of holomorphic sections with the number of elements here is as close to the dimension of the space, and moreover they are uniformly bounded. So this is, we have this more general result which applies not only to the sphere, but when restricted to the case of the projective space, we recover the previous statement. So this is what we prove. And the way to prove it is, well, the strategy is the following. We need to find a net of well-distributed points in the manifold. Then we need to construct sections that peak in these points and they are almost orthonormal. So this is very contrary to what we want at the end, because what we want, they are sections that are orthonormal but which do not peak at all. They want them to be flat, right? So, but first, we will build them in such a way that they peak a lot, that they are very concentrated near the points. Then we will orthonormalize this thing. These were not orthonormal. We will orthonormalize them while keeping this property that they peak. And then we will make like linear combinations of this orthogonal system to flatten it while keeping the orthogonality. That's the scheme. And well, finally, we need to estimate the size, how many how many points can I construct. Very good. So that's the scheme. How do we do this? We will use the Fekete points. Eh? And the Fekete points, so we take, so in the sense, since everything here is constructive, so if you follow here the proof, you get really estimates on the size of the thing. So the point here is, we start with an orthonormal basis of sections, and we take the Fekete point. So this is the point, remember, this determinant was maximal. And these points were well distributed, we proved that they converged uniformly everywhere. And moreover, this is the piece that I just stated at the end of last lecture, the collection of the Fekete points, they are not an interpolating sequence for the space of sections, but almost. I mean, this thing is, I'm taking the Fekete points not at level k, but of some smaller smaller set. I mean, see, if we were this is, you have to either enlarge the space a bit, consider a space of degree slightly bigger than the Fekete, or just consider the Fekete points from some smaller set. So here we have the number of points here is not the dimension. It's slightly less because I'm reducing the size. But what is true is that the Fekete points are interpolating for H0, for LK. So that means, interpolating means that for any section, for any values, we can find an holomorphic section here, we take the prescribed values at the points, at the Fekete points, and moreover we have control of the L2 norm of the section. All right, so just the standard definition of interpolation in L2. Good. So Fekete points were related to interpolating sequences. That's what, and now, what do we do? We have a set of Fekete points which are very uniformly distributed, which have almost the dimension of the space, and which are interpolating. Then I take the reproducing kernels, picking at the points, these are going to be my peak sections, my peak functions there. So I take the reproducing kernels at these Fekete points. These are Sj, I call them Sj, are the Fekete points, the reproducing kernels. They have very good of diagonal estimates when the metric is positive. As I told you, we have some exponential decay. Away from the point, we have some exponential decay as k goes to infinity. We had a very good of diagonal estimate. So moreover, the fact that the points are interpolating, well, if the points are interpolating, this is equivalent to saying that the Gramian matrices of the Gramian matrix of the scalar product of the reproducing kernel, this should be bounded below in little L2. This is an equivalent definition of being interpolating. No? So this matrix is bounded below. Okay. Now, we know that this G is this Gramian matrix is invertible because of this they are interpolating in L2, but moreover it has a very fast of diagonal decay, the matrix, because this product is just, these were reproducing kernels, this is just the evaluation of Sj at the other points pk, and they were uniformly separated. So that means that we have a diagonal, we have a matrix which is invertible in L2, and when I go away, I don't know what happens in a band, maybe. In a band here, they may not, but as I move away from a band, they decay very fast. This has a very fast decay. And then, okay. What happens here is that if we have a matrix which is, there are results of localization that say that whenever we have a matrix which is very fast decaying away from the diagonal and invertible in L2, the inverse has the same property. The inverse will have also a very fast decay away from the diagonal. And also the inverse to the power minus 1/2. And of course, if I take this g to the minus 1/2, and I take the sections here, these new sections, coming from this from these sections are orthonormal. So these were not orthonormal, I'm just orthonormalizing. And moreover, if psi j is given by this combination and this matrix has this property of fast off diagonal decay, these psi j are also localized near the points. Okay, so the new system, which is orthonormal, it's just a small perturbation, if you want, of what we had before. So these are now orthonormal, and they have the same sort of estimate, of diagonal estimate, as the original reproducing kernels had. Yeah, and now, instead of having these psi j's, I take this linear combination with these roots of unity here, with these powers of roots of unity, and you can check clearly that this is still orthonormal. This new system is orthonormal, and the nice thing about these ones is that this has small L infinity size. And in order to check that this has a small supremum size, the key point is that since we had this localization for these psi's, these are very localized, there are really, when I sum them up, there is really very little interference, because I'm summing up things which have essentially like this joint support. Yeah, and therefore, this sum is not increasing, they never peel up. And I'm dividing by the number of the square root of the dimension, so this makes these new sections very flat. And this is the way that that we manage to get uniform control on the sections. Okay, so these are the two applications that I had in mind, and I just wanted to close with a couple of open problems. No, I mean on Fekete points. Well, the first one, it's a very classical. It's this problem by Smail. And I just tell you one little input that there is on this. The first one is by Smail, and it says the following: we are in the sphere. And we have Fn, it's a collection of Fekete in the sphere. And now the Fekete, they minimized this logarithmic energy. And it is it has been computed, this is some work by Rakshenko, Saf, and Zhu, the energy, the logarithmic energy of this thing is of this type. And Cn is in between, well, the Lim soup. So this is not about the location of the Fekete points, but rather about the energy that the Fekete points have. So the energy of the Fekete points behaves like, it explodes like n squared, the next term is an n log n, and the next term, it's not known whether this is an n or not. I mean, one would like to know whether this is like an n, but this is not. What's known is that this is something in between -0.22n and -0.04n, right? So this is the... this is the behavior of the energy. And the problem of the, well, it will be nice, of course, to have a more precise asymptotic expression for the energy. But the problem that Smail asked whether it's possible, this is one of these problems for the century, the seventh, I think that's what he called it. That's he asked whether it's possible to construct some points, say fn tilde, not to look for the Fekete points. Fekete points are this thing. It's only good from a theoretical point of view, because I said here we use it some applications, for instance in this one, but there is no way to get your hands on the Fekete points. There is no way of numerically computing them, right? So this is not good, and what one can do is the other way. One he was asking is whether one could find approximate Fekete points. Find Fn approximate Fekete points. That means that the energy associated to this, well, he was asking a lot, eh? So that this is of the order log n. So that we are close to in at the energy level to log n, but this should be computable with polynomial time. So that was the question, to find because this is usually good enough for most applications, right? So to find a way to construct things which are close to the Fekete points. This is hard because we don't even know what's the energy of the real ones. I mean, so, but what I was trying to say, okay, this is an open problem, but it seems not very easy. But what I was just wanted to mention is that the energy, in the first application, I was using the Fekete points in order to get information on the spherical ensembles. But it's usually done the other way around. The other way around, in the sense that in order to get, it has been proposed to use as fn tilde, to use just a realization of the spherical ensemble. So instead of building to solve the problem of Smale probabilistically, instead of finding a deterministic fn tilde, I'm just going to find it a random fn tilde in such a way that very likely I will have a solution. Right? So you just throw away the picture that I showed you before. You just throw these 2,000 points. I mean, this is possible to, there are algorithms that in polynomial time, like n to the cube, they find you these eigenvalues. So the eigenvalues can be found in polynomial time of a matrix. Now, once we have this, it's possible to prove that the expectation of the energy, this has been computed. This is, okay, what's the expectation of the energy? It's 1/2 So it is, it's actually easy to compute the expectation of the, yes, since in St. Petersburg I wanted to use it. So this, the expectation of these spherical ensembles is this thing. And it's, well, at least the two first terms matches the thing, but it actually, this was very, I was, this was, it's very tempting to conjecture that this is the right thing, but it is not, because there are other random point processes, which are just, you could consider, instead of random matrices, random polynomials, with coefficients which are, you take these polynomials that we had, we orthonormalized them, and we take the coefficients to be normal now. And we construct a polynomial of degree n, and we build the zeros. one can prove again that these zeros are uniformly distributed, and in that case, so there are other random processes which are constructed instead of with random matrices, with random polynomials, in such a way that this is done. This is Bertrand and Shoup. Little often, and this is smaller energy than this thing here. So I don't know. I don't know what's the answer, and I don't know how to construct things. This is also a random construction. Eh? So I don't know what's that's a good way to construct deterministically randomly points which are close to the right energy. So these are the by the way, these random constructions are better than any other deterministic. You try to split the sphere very nicely in little pieces, very regular, putting a point, and you get worse energies than if you take them at random. So these random constructions are better than any deterministic construction that's known. So the hope is to find some other random point processes, because there are other with polyanalytic function, I don't know, that that provide better estimates than these ones. So, and I think I will stop here.
So this CL is there if you have.
Yeah.
How do they compare with these two, if you compare with the random things that you
Well, you just can check out. I think
they are in between.
They are in between.
How big is this log?
Log 2?
Minus gamma over.
I don't know, check it out. I don't know.
Minus 1/2, minus log is less than minus 1/2.
Yeah, but this is negative, eh?
Yeah.
Both are negative. But this is... minus 0.22, no? Yeah, this is...
This is
smaller,
no?
Yeah, there must be something fishy here. Yeah, this is not... There's something wrong here, but I can give you the reference, yeah. Yeah, this 0.2 must be...
What's your
number
that implies that 0.5 is less than...
Yeah. Sorry.
Okay, then just finish the sticker again.